Thank you very much, Dr. Deepak, for giving me this opportunity to speak in front of all the esteemed guests and students. My views about the myth versus reality, what literature has and what my understanding is about functional appliances with the literature available in with the literature available till date. So let me start with a statement that the functional appliance, the best definition which I admire is given by Bishara. The functional appliance, which refers to the variety of appliances which are designed to alter the arrangements of various muscle groups that influence the function and position of mandible in order to transmit forces to dentition and basal bone by altering the mandibular position sagittally, vertically, resulting in an orthodontic and orthopedic changes. So I would be uncovering these facts that how functional appliances work in the roadmap, which I would like to take would be starting the timing of class two treatment, when the class two treatment should be initiated. The second would be, can we make the mandibles grow? So are they growing? What is the effect of the growth on the of the treatment on the mandibular growth? Third would be, what is the effect seen on the soft tissue response, mainly the effect on muscle, the surroundings, air structures, that is the TMJ. Third, what is the choice of the appliance, whether removable versus fixed, or what is the correlation when we say that this we can use class 2 elastics, or can we substitute class 2 elastics versus fixed functional appliances? Some other considerations which will be covered, that is, what is the design of the appliance, what are the modifications we can do in the design of the appliance, the effect on the airway, etc., and bite registrations. So what is the timing of a functional appliance? Why it is important? So there is an old saying, a stitch in the time saves 9, which basically means that the promptness is better. So if we act timely, the results are good. So by this saying, if we go, we always try to treat any class 2 or a growing child with a class 2 malocclusion with a retruded mandible whenever he reports to our clinic. But we could go wrong. So the timing of the function appliance is also very important, because it has to, the appliance therapy has to match with the growth peak of the child. So what is the growth peak of the child? So the early treatment with functional appliance is always recommended, but with a myth that as soon as the child walks into your clinic, one should start giving the functional appliance therapy. That is the myth which always is existed with us. So the fundamental concept behind the treatment timing is that it should be always coinciding with the peak mandibular growth and the time when you give the functional appliance. So the graph which is depicted here, the cases, or if the child gets the functional appliance during the pubertal maturation, when he is in the peak of the maturity, he would show better results. If you see that the growth curve, the growth timing in boys, normally the growth curve of the growth in the condyles and the peak height velocity are coinciding, and it is between the age of 12 to 16 years. So any boy who is given a functional appliance during this treatment would show better results with functional appliance, whereas the timing for the females in the peak velocity curve, if you see, the peak velocity curve for girls is early as compared to boys. It's basically 1 or 2 years prior as compared to boys. So the timing or the selection of the case, depending on the sex, would definitely matter because of the growth curves in their peak height velocity curves. So according to Besita and Franchi, the appearance of growth peak curve can be seen clearly on a lateral cephalogram, which we normally when the patient comes to us. And if the concavity is seen in the cervical vertebra too, we can say that it is coinciding with the peak height velocity curve of the journal body growth. And the patient is in an ideal case to begin with a functional jaw orthopedics. The studies given by Pancheus also says that in 1991, he concluded that what I wanted to say that if any case which is in CVMI 3 and 4 is coinciding with the peak height velocity curve. So according to Pancheus also, he said in 1991 and concluded by his study that the late in Herbst cases, which was treated in the permanent dentition, has advantage and in the stability, because after the treatment, there was a good intercuspation attained after the functional appliance therapy, which is very important for the stability of the case, and there is less relapse. So if you see these two bars, if we start early, of course, there is a change seen in the overjet and overbite. The overjet reduces, but the amount of relapse is also equally high. That is around 36%. And in molar relation, it was 29% by Pancheus, which was post-Herbst treated cases. Whereas in cases which were treated late, the changes were around 79% because of the overjet relapse reduced to 8%. So the timing is important. So it is not that if we start early, we are getting good results. It is when to start. If patient is in the peak height velocity stage, the results would be far better. And the selection of the case. Selection means if you are selecting a case where the gonial angle is smaller than 125, the expected change would be definitely better than a case with having a high gonial angle. So a class 2 patient in a skeletal maturation CS3 with a gonial angle smaller than 125 is expected to respond better with fixed functional jaw orthopedics. Now, the study done by Dr. Vichare stating that the case selection would be good if it is a horizontal grower. But the studies which he, the results of her study states that both high angle cases and low angle cases would respond equally well if are given the fixed functional appliances. The choice of appliance in her study was mainly activator and twin block appliances. The amount of sagittal change observed in her study that both showed equal amount of changes in the terms of sagittal because of the non-trimming of the occlusal surfaces in a vertical cases. So the only limitation in her study which was that the selection of the cases were not, they did not see that which, what was the FMA prior to the treatment and the cases were not selected according to the FMA and they were given randomly. So it had a, this study has few limitations and further studies are recommended to see that what is the rotational control in the vertical and the horizontal axis. So the myth was when to start and when the results are stable and early treatment would give better results. So the fact is that early treatment with functional appliances do not show the end results in terms of increase in length when compared to cases which were treated later. The only high evidence is that the incidence of incisal trauma is reduced. And when the incisal incidence to incisal trauma is reduced and the child gains self-confidence, it is the only, the psychological aspect are the only two facts to start the case in an early stages. So we have to be very careful when we are selecting a case, when to start early. If you have to satisfy these two factors, that if the child esteem his psychological thing has to be boosted, then you should start early so that some confidence is gained between in him and he is confident among his peer group, and to avoid the incisal trauma. These are the only two factors which literature supports. Second, the child who is growing in CS3 and is in favorable growth and it is in late permanent dentition would have more stable results. This is in the Cochrane database, which has been reported. So these facts are the only established facts and which we can actually take into consideration. So the next question is, are we really growing mandibles? Growing mandibles means, is there any dento-alveolar or skeletal changes which are seen? Everybody says that the mandibular length has grown. So the myth is, how far the mandibles can be grown? Is it only the skeletal effect what is seen? Normally it is seen that we say when we give twin block, there are 60 to 70% skeletal changes and 30 to 40% dental changes. Another appliance, any fixed appliance would show 60% and 40%. So what are these percentages? Are these myths or reality? So this is the myth we are still having. And any functional appliance would, how it would act? Any functional appliance would work on class 2 by increasing the mandibular growth, restraining the maxillary growth, that is the headgear effect, giving dent changes, that means backward tipping of upper incisors and forward inclination of the lower incisors, thereby reducing the overjet, and the differential eruption which we take by clearing the occlusal plane, that is leveling the curve of SP, increasing the anterior lower fascia. So this is how any functional appliance works. Now, if you see the systematic review, there are many articles available, but the systematic review, which is available regarding the renewable functional appliances in patient with class 2 malocclusion and a meta-analysis, it states that the skeletal effect of renewable functional appliances are minimum. They are very minimal. So the amount of actual change in the length or the skeletal effect are very minimal or negligible, and they are only seen when compared with the natural growth. If you do not treat a case with a functional appliance, then also those amount of changes are seen if they are left untreated and when they are compared with untreated individuals. So a renewable functional appliance would show a very minimal and probably negligible clinical importance. And the treatment with renewable functional appliance associated with minimal stimulation growth, mandibular growth, and a minimal restriction of maxillary growth to a larger extent, the only changes would be the changes in the soft tissue changes and the dento-alveolar changes. So what we are talking that what functional appliance brings about, only changes are seen as dento-alveolar changes and soft tissue adaptation. And if we are comparing with the fixed functional appliance, the evidence what fixed functional appliances systematic states, this is also supporting. There are few systematic reviews which are available stating what how the fixed functional appliance would work. They all conclude that there is a limited high quality evidence. seen are to be mainly dentabular, even in patients treated during puberty. So even if they are in peak height velocity, the skeletal changes, that skeletal changes means changes seen in the actual increase in the mandibular length are very minimal. Only the changes which are appreciated are in the neuromuscular changes or the dentoalveolar changes. So it appears that the fixed functional appliances also have a very limited role in giving us skeletal changes as far as the dentoalveolar changes. The long-term effect of functional appliance treated versus untreated patient, a systematic review, a latest study would support that to assess the skeletal and the soft tissue effects on the lateral cephalograms produced by the functional appliance in treated versus untreated cases in a long-term effect, which is a minimum 3 years effect after retention. This is the only study which says that the quality of evidence is very low for most of the outcomes of both primary time point and clinical significance of these findings. So this is basically stating that the evidence is very, very low, and the amount of myth what we had that anything that the mandible actually grows and there is a skeletal change, it is only stating that the rate of growth is enhanced, but the quantity seems to be less. What this statement is making us understand that yes, whatever the patient had to achieve in terms of the growth potential, the rate is enhanced, means you see that result, but not enhanced the inbuilt ability of that mandible to grow. So you can modify, you can change the period when it will show its effect, but it will not show the potential in increase. So possibility of short-term increase in the mandibular growth is seen. However, effect on the long-term skeletal treatments are weak and insignificant. As it is very clear in this figure that if you are expecting the growth peak to be a case where if you leave the patient untreated, this is how the growth curve would occur. Whereas if we intervene with a functional appliance, this growth curve would increase a very limited time. And this growth curve would flatten it out and would match with the actual growth curve what an individual would have if it would have not been even treated with a functional appliance. So a true stimulation of growth curve is not seen. If at all a functional appliance would have stimulated a true stimulation curve, it would have not fallen back or would have not come back once the treatment with functional appliance therapy would have been reduced or would have been tapered off, or the appliance would have discontinued. So a myth which was that we can enhance the skeletal changes, I think the reality is that we can only get those changes early and we cannot enhance the growth curve. It gets only enhanced as a temporary acceleration stage. But yes, then we do see the changes in the patient. We are happy with the profiles. We do get good VTOs. This is the response of the functional appliance therapy on the soft tissue, which we need to analyze. So a mandibular advancement of class 2 correlation leads to bony changes by activation of jaw protruding muscles. So how these muscles are acting in bringing the change in the class 2? This is animation to state that any bite blocks, when they come in contact, it is an animation with a twin block. Once they come in contact, there is a proprioception generated through the PDL, through the teeth and the bony structures. So this stimulus, which is the proprioceptive stimulus, it is transmitted to the higher centers. And when it is transmitted to the higher centers, there is a reflex change. And this actually activates the motor cortex, which leads to the activating signals to the jaw for protruding the muscles, that is lateral pterygoid and the surrounding retrodiscal pad area. So the muscles around the retrodiscal pad, once the mandible comes forward, they get stimulated, and which acts directly on the mandibular condylar cartilage and indirectly through the vascular supply to the TMJ, thus stimulating the condyles to grow with a protrusive movement of the mandible. So two possible mechanism comes into play to fill the tension zone, that is growth of the cartilage plus remodeling of the glenoid fossa. So if we see that there is a stimulation at the condylar cartilage, so there is a growth at the condylar cartilage, or there is a remodeling of the glenoid fossa. If you see, if you appreciate that there is a protrusion by taking the sagittal bites, when the mandible is brought forward, it relocates from the condylar fossa, and because of the changes at the condylar head and the temporomandibular joint per se, that is the condylar fossa, there is relocation of the condylar fossa, and this is how the entire TMJ area changes because of the relocation of the joint space, that is the glenoid fossa also relocates with the condylar head. So with the forward positioning, what has been advocated that there is a 50% change in the condylar growth along with the glenoid fossa modification and some changes in the muscular pattern. Whereas the rest of the 50% changes are the dental component. Those are the changes in the molar distalization, whereas the tipping of the molar, upper maxillary molars takes place, and the mesialization of the molar and the increase in the IMP area. So the changes are 50% by the remodeling at the condylar head and the glenoid fossa remodeling, whereas the dental changes are also 50%. So contribution of change is equal as compared to dental and skeletal. So the condylar growth and the displacement of glenoid fossa remodeling contributes to approximately 50% of the changes, and parallel to the occlusal plane, decreased postural activity of the superior and inferior head of the masseter and the lateral pterygoids and the anterior digastric muscles. We have also conducted at AIIMS two EMG studies, which was reported in AJO. And the muscle response, what we had seen with the twin block, showed that there is an increase in the muscle activity because of the posture with the bite blocks. In the when we give bite blocks, we increase the bite. So the muscle activity increases for initial 3 months, but it comes back to its baseline after 6 months therapy, and it comes back to zero. So the neuromuscular adaptation, which is seen, this is another article, which is also by our own student Sankalp Sood. And this also states that the neuromuscular adaptation after 6 months of treatment remains stable over the 2 years, because the activity what increases initially comes back to normal, that is to baseline, after 6 months. And the cases which have been followed up for 2 years, the activity remains to the baseline even after you get a sagittal correction. So the masseter, once the activity is changing, there is, once the muscle gets stretched, there is a change in the thickness as well in the muscles once the masseter muscles get activated. So a study which states that the functional appliance lead to mild atrophy of the masseter muscle, possibly because of the decreased functional activity. So when the muscle gets stretched, there is the activity is increased, but it is seen that it leads to dystrophy of the muscle. That is why the changes, the activity which is increased by the muscle in the initial comes back to normal, because most of the muscles shows that there is dystrophy of the muscles. And the functional appliance therapy is thus associated with most of the adaptation of the masticatory muscles. So the role played by the surrounding muscle is by adapting to a newer situation. This is the functional matrix theory, which works more than actually increasing the skeletal changes, what is was myth that actually we are growing the mandible. So it is the functional matrix theory, which is the most important theory, which is showing the effects because of changing the neuromuscular adaptation surrounding the dentition. So what is the effect of the functional appliances in the temporomandibular joint area? So the position of the skeletal alteration in the temporomandibular joint area when compared with the uncontrolled group showed that there was not much of side effects or debilitating effects on the temporomandibular joint area. Once we raise the bite, the effect, the neuromuscular changes adapts the temporomandibular joint area as well, and the results are not detrimental on the temporomandibular joints. The condyle were found to be in a more advanced position with remodeling of condylar head and adaptation of the musculature, that is the morphology of the glenoid fossa, with no significant adverse effect seen on the TMJ as per se, as far as the health of the temporomandibular joints of the patients. That means that appliance could improve the joints that initially presented forward dislocation of the disc. So a fact is that how does this changes? It is because it is proliferating the changes at the condylar head, and it is acting on the genes. It is stimulating the collagen, which collagen matrix changes at the condylar head, and it is regulating this. So the genes are also playing this its role in collagen synthesis. It is not only relocation of the mandible. It is at the genetic level also. There is synthesis of the genes which initiate the cartilage matrix and which helps in the endochondrial ossification at the condylar head. So the changes which are seen, these are all on the animal studies. No human studies are available to state that what is having at the genetic level. So the fact remains that the changes which are seen in the condylar head or the dentoalveolar complex is not only associated, but we have the genetic component also to support, and the regulation of the collagen synthesis, the stimulation at the blood vessel and the endochondrial bone growth, which is seen at the condylar head. So now another myth which is there, that whether the removable or the functional appliances, fixed functional appliance acts better. And what is the relationship of class 2 elastics with the fixed functional appliances? Wherever we are using a multi-banded therapy, we can be use class 2 elastics to get the same effect. So the myth that the removable functional appliances are not much effective as compared to fixed functional appliance, that is a myth which is there. Now the fact is if we see a systematic review which states that there is a very little difference in the dental and the skeletal effects seen in the fixed and the removable functional appliances. So whether you treat a case with a removable or with a fixed functional appliances, the amount of the dental and the skeletal changes are the same. So it is not whether you are doing with removable or you are doing with fixed, the amount of the change seen by both the appliance are the same. Most of the correction in the overjet was demonstrated where the alveolar movement, which was seen in very small increments in the skeletal changes, that by 1 or 2 millimeter, there is a skeletal change, whether it is done with the removable or with the fixed. There is a greater only thing that we say that the compliance is better with a fixed functional therapy, whereas the child would not wear the removable functional appliance. So the compliance with the appliance is better if we are using fixed functional. It is that the compliance is whether the compliance is with the removable or with the fixed, results are going to be same, and there is no such thing as non-compliance or treatment therapy. So stating that the fixed functional appliance would have better compliance also is not a very, it's also a myth, it is fact. Now we say class 2 elastics. Now class 2 elastics are not as good as functional appliances for class 2 correction. I feel that after reading this article that a correction of class 2 occlusion with class 2 elastic a systematic review, our views are going to change. A class 2 correction with class 2 elastics is primary dentoalveolar changes, whereas with fixed functional appliances also there is a dentoalveolar changes. The results with fixed functional appliances are similarly in long-term effects with class 2 elastics. If we compare, the results are the same, but I just want to state here, the selection of the case, whether to use a fixed functional appliance or to use a class 2 elastics is the only thing which we as clinicians have to choose. When we see the biomechanics, how class 2 works, if we give a class 2 elastics, we see that there is a retraction in the maxillary incisors, crystallizing effect in the maxilla, and because of the class 2 components, the lower mandible or the lower dentition moves mesially. But there is a very two components, extrusive component in the anterior segment, that means the upper incisor segment, and the extrusive component on the lower molar. So the cases where you would like to get the extrusive component, the selection of cases where you would like these extrusive component and it will be beneficial for your case, you can select class 2 elastics in correcting the class 2 molar relationship. That means with class 2 elastics, there would be a downward and backward rotation of the mandible. So if you feel that your case requires a downward and the backward rotation of the mandible, class 2 elastics would be as effective as any fixed functional appliance. Whereas a case where you feel that you cannot afford to extrude the molars and you want a case where, because functional appliance works with a continuous action, and the continuous action would be that it is giving a distalizing effect on the molar and the maxilla and a mesializing effect on the lower dentition and the mandible, there is no downward and backward rotation of the mandible because it is a push kind of appliance and it is a continuous action. So the selection of the cases, if you select a case, both are going to work well. So the maintenance of the mandibular plane is, if it is required, fixed functional appliances would be a better option. Whereas if you need to change the mandibular plane, that means if you need to change the downward and backward rotation of the mandible, even a class 2 elastics can work well. So another considerations which I said that the thing whether a stepwise advancement versus maximum by jumping is another consideration. Role of incisal capping, these are where you are taking a bite, whether to advance the mandible forward maximum or a stepwise. Role of incisal capping is also debatable, whether a part-time or a full-time wear protocol are also existing in literature, whether a full-time functional appliance would work or a part-time functional appliance would also give you a similar results. And the skeletal anchorage in conjunction with fixed functional appliances, because of the side effects of any functional appliance, which states that there is a proclination of lower incisors, which can be prevented by taking skeletal anchorage, is beneficial. Now, what is the role of fixed functional appliance is obstructive sleep apnea and the effect on the airway. So these are the other considerations and the myths which we have in literature. There are few newer therapies which are seen in literature where it is stating that the condylar remodeling can be enhanced by gene therapy and giving laser therapy so that the treatment time can be reduced and the effect seen on the dentition can be reduced. So an article, a systematic review regarding stepwise mandibular advancement. It states that although the magnitude of differences in the clinical practice was limited, it is always seen that if you are advancing in stepwise, you are stimulating muscles at different intervals. And initially, we have seen that more of the changes are seen with the neuromuscular adaptations. So enhancing the bite in a single step and stepwise would always show better results in stepwise, because the remodeling what is occurring because of the stimulation of the muscle is in an incremental effect. So the changes with stepwise are always better than a single step. But at the level of current evidence is low, more high quality RCTs are needed, because it is only very few studies. There are very few RCTs to support this literature. A study, only study which is existing in literature regarding the incisal capping, these were the cases which was treated with twin block, and this had 55 cases where the twin blocks were given. Half of them were with the incisal capping and half of them did not have incisal capping. It was a prospective study, and this also stated that there was not much of change in the inclination of the incisors, whether they were capped or they were not capped. So incisal capping also shows a very weak evidence now. More studies needs to be done. Good systematic review in the modification of the design was done in the Herbst appliance as compared to the twin block with incisal capping. And this was also reported that although the Herbst appliance showed much better results in terms of class 2 as compared to twin block, but in terms of inclination of the lower incisors, whether you cap them or you don't cap them, the unwanted side effects on the proclination was also seen with a capped Herbst appliance. So the evidence states the capping do not actually reduces the inclination angle of the lower incisors. This was now what is the role of the skeletal anchorage? As I said that there are number of articles and students can look upon if they search the literature. they are few case reports, or they are just the retrospective studies. They are very few systematic reviews which can say that the skeletal anchorage can help in reducing the ill effects on, or the reducing the dentoalveolar effects and more of skeletal effects. So the currently available evidence is insufficient to form a conclusion. That is why there are now literature seen with more use of mini plate anchored fixed functional appliances. There are few randomized clinical control trials which are being conducted that whether the mini plates can be used successfully in increasing the effective mandibular length in short term effect. Now, because more of the changes were seen in the lower incisor proclination, and to review that the unfavorable effect on the lower incisors can be avoided. Now, if you see the results, that if the mandibular advancement is done and a pitchfork is actually done for a case where only forces is used, the results what it showed was that the there was a restricting effect on the maxilla. The mandible also showed a came forward. There was a restraining effect on the maxillary dentition. There was a restraining effect on the maxillary molar, but the changes in the mandibular dentition was very evident. The molar also moved forward, and there was proclination of the lower incisors. Whereas if a mandibular advancement is done with the help of mini plates with forceps appliance, the amount of changes, yes, there was a restraining effect on the maxilla, but to a higher extent as compared to a only with forceps appliance. There was much more mandibular advancement with mini plate anchored forceps. There was a restraining effect on the maxilla comparable to a forceps appliance. There was minimum change in the dental inclination in the mandibular dentition, which was quite evident. But if we see the overall correction in the overjet, here you will see that if we are assessing these 16% of the skeletal changes were seen in the overall, once we assess in the overjet correction, once only with forceps appliance, the 84% was the dental correction which was shown. And out of this 84 also, if you see, it was in the maxilla, it was 39%, and in the mandible, it was 45%. Whereas if you compare with the mini plate, the skeletal changes were 40%, and the dental changes, whereas it, when it was 84%, it came down to 60%. So the dental changes could be reduced if we are taking a bone anchored support with a fixed functional appliance. As I said, that the effect on the mandibular incisor was actually reduced to 9%, whereas with only forces, it was shown as 45%. So a literature is supporting a skeletal anchorage system in getting less dentoalveolar change as compared to fixed functional appliances if they are used with a multi-banded therapy. Now, another area where we say that part-time with full-time protocol. In literature, there is a study which states a randomized clinical trial which shows that there was no difference in either the dental or the skeletal changes when the patient was asked to wear a twin block for full time or for a partial time. That means they were asked to wear for 9 to 12 hours and One group was asked to wear for 24 hours, and they were asked to use with meals and without meals. And they were followed up for 12 months. So a patient who wear the plate appliances for part-time, they also showed similar results with patients who were wearing for full-time appliances. So a part-time versus full-time also is a debatable thing now. When we say we choose an appliance twin block, stating that it is a 24 hours wearing appliance. So same 24 hour wearing appliance, if it is used partially, can also give a similar effect than a case with a full-time wearing appliance. Another study, which is a very latest study in literature in 2020, it states that the effect of wear time differences in renewable functional appliances in patient. Now, this is a prospective MRI study, and of TMJ, the changes what they have seen. It's a three-dimensional study, and a neuromuscular adaptation changes also was evaluated. This states that the study was carried out using a cephalometric radiographs and an MRI of 20 class 2 patients who were treated with monoblocks and twin block appliances. The patients were divided into two groups, 10 patients in class 1 who wear the appliance for all the day, while 10 patients were instructed to wear during sleep only. The cephalometric and the MRI findings for these studies show that the treatment effects were similar for both the groups. So even the three-dimensional changes with two different kind of appliances, at the timing of or the wear time, whether you reduce it or you use it for 24 hours, are showing similar results. So what is the effect on the functional appliances on OSA? Now, OSA, a lot of study has been reported in literature. There are two studies reported from Chandigarh as well. I believe that there was a thesis topic given to assess the airway, the amount of airway change, and with patients who were treated with twin block appliances. Now, when you see the OSA patients' literature, there is a lot of evidence that the appliances which bring the mandible forward, there are supporting the literature that the patients do improve clinically once they are using these appliances. And there is a mild to minimum to mild patients change are seen. They are not very severe cases, and we can help them by giving these appliances if they are in a pubertal stages, so that the changes in the neuromuscular adaptation and the position of the mandible can help in reducing the airway problem in OSA patients. A long-term treatment was only available seen in literature is the 6 month post-treatment, and they are not maybe more effective if the appliances are used for more than 6 months time, and they are used in an early stage when there is a pubertal peak, so that we can help the patients in OSA patients. One systematic review has come up very recently. I would say that this is a systematic review, but this did not, it also had limitation. It did not have RCTs included in the systematic review. The data which they have reported, they were, most of them were retrospective studies. They also say that there is a significant improvement in the pharyngeal airway passage dimension, and there is a minimum effect on the nasopharyngeal airway passage, and a minor improvement was mainly due to the growth if they were given to a patient when they were growing. The improvements were more on the oropharyngeal airway passage dimension, and they were very promising. So a renewable functional appliances were more efficient than a fixed functional appliances if you are looking at the improvement in the pharyngeal airway dimensions. So renewable appliances always have shown better results than the fixed functional appliances. The changes observed in the higher bone position distance was also very prominent in horizontal than in vertical. So this was the conclusion given by this systematic review with few limitations in their own study. Now, what is the future of the functional appliances in what we have discussed? We have discussed that there is the extent of significant growth, what is seen at the skeletal level, it is still controversial. We still have to have more studies to state that the effect on the skeletal is more and there is less of dento-alveolar changes once we the studies are there but the level of evidence is very low. So high quality evidence RCTs, longitudinal 3D studies with large sample size are still needed to validate or use of these functional appliances regularly or how they affect the skeletal changes. Now the adaptation of TMJ and neuromuscular adaptations, although literature supports them, but we lack in long-term effect changes. The maximum what we could see was the Sankalp study, which was a two-year follow-up. So we need to have more neuromuscular to evaluate the changes and in the stability of class twos. Post-treatment, long-term studies are needed and we have lacuna in literature. And of course, the effect of growth stimulating hormones and the role of laser in remodeling the changes at the glenoid fossa, they are still under experimental stages. No human studies are available, only at the experimental animal studies are there. So we need to see whether the growth hormones and the accelerated growth do have some effect on the remodeling at the glenoid fossa. Another area which we need to work upon is the long-term stability of patients which are treated early because of the psychological effects and the demand from the patients and before realizing that when to start. So the early treatments which started, what is the long-term stability in those cases? That is also very few studies are there. So long-term stability with timing, when to start, their early times have really supported only psychological effects. So the literature is lacking in long-term stability for early treatments also. So friends, a journey of 1,000 miles must begin with a single step. That is a quote which I would like to state here. We still have miles to go before we all sleep over this. Although functional appliances is a good appliance, but we still have too many goals to achieve when we say that the functional appliances are beneficial for the kind of patients we are treating. Thank you very much for patient listening.